Okay, so at this point, it's my great pleasure to introduce our next keynote speaker. He is the former White House Presidential Innovation Fellow at the Office of Science, Technology, and Policy, White House Presidential Innovations Fellow. As a catalyst in the robotics AI revolution, he has served as the robotics AI work streams in the Obama administration's White House, Office of Science, Technology, and Policy. He has over 20 years of experience building companies, including successful experiences as a venture capitalist, championing early stage investments in household brands such as Hotmail and TiVo. His early career quant work has held positions as a global executive, investor, and advisor to many information technology companies, including Six as co-founder. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Eric Daimler to the stage.
Thanks for being Mass Constant and being our co-host in Mass TLC, Mass Robotics, MITC sale, for inviting me to come up here and see what I think is the largest construction site since the Big Dig. That's why they had me come up here to do that and see how many PhDs it takes to play with computer sensors. All I just don't have them all. I think we are keeping you from donuts at the break, so I'll just say I want to cover all the material and then I'll be available most of the day for follow-up questions. But first we're going to look at an aircraft carrier. It's a nice way to start out. And how many know that this is not how an aircraft carrier is supposed to look? Right? It'd be a good guess. So this is it's an aircraft carrier in distress. This doesn't happen very often. And the last time this happened was during World War II. It's happening right here under a different type of distress. This is an aircraft carrier that we decided United States at war to send into a typhoon. Not a really good idea. And it was actually with tragic consequences because you see those planes on the end, many of them actually washed overboard, actually created an enormous fire inside the aircraft carrier. 120 planes were lost, almost lost the aircraft carrier, and two destroyers. You can imagine how big these things are, actually capsized. 720 sailors were lost from weather. So we don't do that anymore, and one reason we don't do that anymore is because these random events, these seemingly disparate data points out in the world, we didn't have a lot of knowledge for us about the patterns that would allow us to sail safely. It's not like aircraft carriers are built to go through a typhoon, it's just that we don't go through them anymore. So we spent money and developed science around predicting weather, right? So we have a prediction quality around this domain. The point for that when we went into public policy is we notice a lot of people in the world think that they can predict technology and they don't do so well. They think they can predict the short-term resolution of their dreams. And you know, the old saying about venture capitalism, you know, don't confuse a clear vision with a short time horizon. That's a clear vision. We all want Rosie the robot. But we also know that those developments are not necessarily inevitable. And the way we might develop them for others, I think some of the things around which we were concerned in the White House might be threatening to some people, right? They actually might be of a concern. So when I came into the White House, I was asked, what do you want to do while you're there? And I said, well, really what I'd like to do is I'd like to shift the narrative from that of robots killing people or taking your jobs to something more productive. And that, of course, has some demographic issues, right? Generations will adapt to technologies a little bit differently, of course. But really, the point is we need to engage with society. We need to have them part of the conversation to know what's threatening and what's not threatening. Sam gave a fantastic lead-in into this talk because much of technology is a black box, not only to us. But you think if it's a black box to us about how these algorithms work, how can we really be trusted to deliver the news to a general population? So Yeah, so this is not a picture of me briefing the president, just so you know. I would not be, he would not be smiling or laughing while I was briefing him. That's, but this is a picture of some of my colleagues. This whole slide deck, by the way, this is the result of not having a staff at the White House. So this is what you get when you're putting it together yourself, okay? It's lean government dollars at work. This is just a group of us that were brought in, not me this time in this room, were brought in to bring a technology sensibility into what's the Office of Science and Technology Policy. It was kind of smaller under Bush 43, after it got really blew up in a good way under Obama, the most technically adept or technically inquisitive president since Jefferson, we always liked to say. I can talk about this current administration first. The guy with the glasses to the right, the guy smiling, somebody can remember, that's Todd Park. He was the CTO that really rescued Daimler, guy, celebrity in my eyes, somebody that really credit with coming in from the NIH or the HHS to solve a big problem for us. So out of all this work that we did in wanting to shift the narrative, what we did is with a team of people, we had a national conversation. We went to Boston, to New York, to Washington, to Stanford, to Carnegie Mellon, to Seattle to talk about AI and the law, AI and social good, AI and sensors and deep technological issues. And we were really encouraged that each of these conversations were standing room only. It was fantastic that we had a broad swath of the population from deep technologists to people in business to just lay people interested in the conversation. The output of those conversations were some documents that we meant to have as a roadmap to the next administration. These were those documents. We had about a dozen of these. Anybody read these documents? Yeah, okay. They're actually pretty well written, I think. Thank you. Yeah, you've got reinforcement about that. You can find them all online. I think they're safely there under something like the Obama Archives, Obama Presidency Archives. You can easily search for them. It's about a dozen. I was creating a summary of the work that I had done. There's quite a few interesting documents, all the way from a refresh of the National Robotics Initiative to multiple layers of consideration around AI. This is just a demonstration of one. And so I'm here to not just get a tour of a lovely new campus, but also to give you a summary of the work that I did during the Obama administration in the first 60 days of the Trump administration. And this is it. Be sure to take notes. Yeah, got that down. It's not just that the level at which we work in there is kind of as a meta level, suggesting policies that then could result in regulation. It's that this is really the synthesis around which I suggest we all allow in our sensibilities at the very earliest stages of developing technology. And the reason is because I think this technology has an impact that's beyond other things that we have brought into our world as technologists. It's going to affect agriculture, it's going to affect medicine. We obviously see the ubiquitous driving cars in virtually every big city in the United States. And the problem with that is that some of these technologies are as the same problem, right, as that are uncertain in their implementation. And the road ahead for the development or the adoption, better said, of these cars and this technology could be bumpy. And the why we care about it being bumpy, because we're intellectual, is an abstraction. We care about being bumpy, but a bump up in front of us could occur like a wall, right? It could be quite disruptive. Just to drill this point home, this is a gold supply. We always think of gold being something that's just continuous, that people argue about getting rid of our fiat currency and going back to gold. If you look at the timeline, it's 200 years. So for 200 years, this might be smooth. You know, the adoption of our technology could be smooth if you have a good enough x-axis. but on a short enough time horizon, this could be bumpy. And that actually, if you're not conscious of that, say over the next 4 years, you could be irresponsible to your investors, to your board, and even to your customers. And we could experience a backlash. And to look at how we could possibly have a backlash, we can look back. We have a conjunction. Was anybody able to predict that what came after this technology development was this? And look at that trust issue here, right? I don't know what the woman's doing, but she doesn't look like she's quite trusting. Maybe she wants to drive, but I mean, she's saying, I don't know, slow down, avoid the swirl, but anybody predict that what came after this is this? Or this? You know, technology development, we can think again about a clear vision of what's going to happen, Rosie the Robot out in the distant future, but nobody said we're going to go from this to this, or then to this, right? And no one's going to say whether or not this is the next reality. Is it good or bad? Is it a good or bad robot? Come on. I'm not giving anything away, but yeah, it's a good robot. It's a good robot. We could have been the Empire's robot. Not giving anything away by saying this is that robot from Star Wars Rogue One, if you could see it last year. And it's an open question about whether it's good or bad. No, it's not an open question. All right. So we'll go back and we'll take a look at the content. So this is a particular development at a particular point of time. This drills home the point of trust. It drills home the issue of predictability of future outcomes. Does anybody know, anybody recall, without doing a search, live search, anybody remember the productivity increase that we experienced with the content? 2x? 3x? Any guesses? 200x? Okay, that's generous. The answer is 25x. That's pretty remarkable. Right? So 100 people no longer need those 100 people. And so we're in that discussion today. Do I eliminate jobs? Do I retrain? Where do I deploy? This is kind of scary. And this gets to the point of thinking about our technology in the very early stages. It's not somebody else's responsibility. Because if we develop technology without consideration for the ultimate adoption, we could have a backlash on this. So what happens with increases in productivity? Demand goes up because why? Price went down. So production goes way up. And so therefore, kind of an unfortunate consequence about how the United States chose to get more labor, but it went way, way up. So anybody remember what the increase in, again, an unfortunate way we did this, but the labor requirements in the United States for cotton because of a 25 increase in productivity? Actually, increased labor demand. Anybody remember how many? Do we need twice as many people? Three times? Five times. Five times is the answer. We need five times as many people, even though we had a 25x decrease in the requirements, you know, per bushel of cotton. This is a kind of the quintessential example about the degree to which robots take jobs or automation takes jobs. And you know, this is a couple hundred years ago. It's not the first time we've experienced an automation question. This is, anytime you're in front of a congressman, I can just tell you firsthand experience, this is the answer you give them, okay? This is what you're telling. And you can also say that the Luddites weren't wrong, just misguided. Okay, this is just how it went, right? They were gonna say, well, robots are gonna take our job. Well, yeah, in a sense, but it actually displaces you. You're gonna do different stuff. So instead of, in the cotton metaphor, you're not just actually staying on the field anymore, you're actually attending to cotton in the manufacturing process, further down the manufacturing process. So, if you take anything away from this, I'd ask you to take away the idea that trends that have historically appeared to be smooth and inevitable, at least even within our lifetimes, may not necessarily continue. So this is preferential trade agreements over a period of time with which we are all familiar. Trade, world trade seems like something that just is part of the natural order of things, the expansion of world trade. So it's a relatively smooth curve. See a little bump around the financial crisis, of course. Uncomfortable one, but it started to recover. But after the recovery, you see that it's shorter and shorter time frame. That's what we're doing with these graphs. You see it started to decline again. So we don't really know what that could be. And so with robots, with AI, with this sort of automation technology, right, we can extrapolate those red bars into what? We don't really know. They're kind of guesses around the as you get farther out. We don't really know. Further, American leadership in technology. We don't really know. It's not really inevitable because other countries invest in robotics and artificial intelligence and machine intelligence just fine. Thank you very much. So it's not inevitable that we'll maintain American leadership. And this is a fine Boston company. You guys see these cars around the street? You don't much, because they're testing in Singapore. Experiment with robotic aquaculture, right? Notice that they're using no soil. I invested in a company like this in the United States, but this is Toshiba. We're not the only ones who could be developing technology like this, and this technology actually needs to be developed. In medical robotics, and we're not the only country in the world, it's not the only region in the world to do this. And other countries are motivated in the same way we are motivated. Just taking one application of the learning technologies around which we're speaking, autonomous driving, and this applies to all the others I talked about in different areas, if not loss of life. This actually literally saves lives. So the work we do actually saves lives. It's the ninth largest cause of death, and I got to show this slide to my mother because I'll share you her accent. But she once got asked, "Is that your son, the doctor?" And she says, "Well, yes, but he's not the type that helps people." But here, you see, road injuries are the ninth largest cause of death globally. 1.3 million people globally get killed from road collisions. 40,000 in the United States. It actually increased over 2016. It went from 33,000 to 40,000. It made a big increase. Could be from texting, could be from driving more, could be longer distances, cheaper fuel, could be whatever. For whatever reason, it increased in the United States. Road deaths. This is actually a real issue. We could quite literally, save lives. And there's other dimensions in which this is really a problem. This is our food production globally, right? This is literally saving lives. It's not actually a distribution problem. If you go into this, we had increase in the White House about soil. We lose 2 tons of topsoil in the United States every year, per acre, 2 tons per acre. It's almost incomprehensible to me. It's a real problem. And it's going to be a problem for our own food supply. Globally, it's already a food supply. So how do we solve that? Historically, how we've solved that is through improvements in technology. And it's going to become a problem. It's really going to become a problem. It's going to become a problem very soon. Right? You see it's becoming a problem already, but I mean, the United States, right? So we need a new technology. We need to adopt this technology. Other countries see this. And other countries already adopt this at a more rapid rate because they're already acculturated to accepting robots in their lives. With a little more acceptance. Again, at the very earliest stages, please let's engage with society about the outcomes they can expect. Please let's engage at the very earliest stages about what adoption will look like. And this might be creating some sort of trust mechanism. I mean, we might have a third-party trust mechanism. There are other trust mechanisms that we've developed in other parts of our world. If we wanted to sell something over to Europe or over to Africa, we'd probably use this. You know, this has been a little bit of a political football in this latest administration. It's probably going to be saved because it actually benefits U.S. exporters. But it's a trust mechanism. It's kind of the point here. And we've developed trust mechanisms in other ways. You know, when these things came out, we said, hey, it'd be really good to have some brake lights, really be good to have some turn signals, right? These are useful. They indicate trust because they set expectations a little bit. And that's also really useful when we set rules of the road about where we expect people to go. I had a friend where he was riding his motorcycle in Europe, and they found themselves confronting another couple of group of riders, and the instinct For the American writers, go right. Instinct for the British writers, go left. Wasn't a good outcome. Everybody's fine, but it wasn't fun at the time. And the other expectation we need to remind people of is accidents happen. You know, trains, you think, are a pretty developed technology, right? Trains, right? This is not deep learning, trains. But something similar like this happened in Hoboken, friggin' New Jersey, like what, 3 months ago? Yeah, sober, clear, high conductor ran the train through the end of the station. So part of this is you set expectations saying, look, as much as you think these things are perfect, they're not going to be perfect, and you have to accept a certain amount of loss. And the point of that is we have developed regulations, through the FDA, we've developed governmental structures that say no amount of loss is acceptable, you know, nothing. It's going to be kind of closed, tight loop. We wouldn't want that sort of regulation in our world. And how you do that is engage very early. You need to tell people, look, there will be an accident. I mean, it just will happen, or there will be, you know, a collision. Bad things will happen. And, you know, as we see with passenger air miles and air safety, as people's interpretation of safety has declined, it's not quite one-to-one, but as safety has increased, passenger air miles for adoption increases. So please work with this trust, work with safety very early in our engagement. This is an increasing part of our world because people are looking even at food supply and saying, well, you know, do I trust it or not trust it? You know, kind of with increased transparency, it can be a little bit trusting, but also you'll have a lot more people wondering, you know, really do I understand it? And the instinct would be to say, no. This is the experience in the government we have right now. You know how we fly around the world as we fly through highways. That's why you can often see when you're crossing the middle of the United States very clearly other planes going the opposite direction. We're on highways and we want to get to what's called next gen air traffic control, where it's point to point. But the FAA, being pilots, traditionally pilots, occupy most every area of the bureaucracy. They are resistant to change themselves because why? They actually don't trust the technology. They literally say, if you want to, I don't know how much you familiarize yourself all with our reports, particularly related to drone technology, but if you wanted to break FAA airspace, which is you want to have a drone come near Logan, you literally have to fax them, visit them in person, or visit them personally or give them a call. Tell me how the drone is going to do that, right? These are pilots. They just expect these analog responses. They don't trust this new technology, and I was engaged in part of this process. But we have experiments with certain robotics companies that are trying to push the boundaries about where we trust, where we don't trust, and to help all of us, all of you, as we develop products at the very early stages, determine the best practices for customer adoption. So anybody familiar with this robot? No one? Come on, it's on Amazon, for goodness sake. It's $200, so you need to go out and buy this guy right away. He's a little robot, about the size of a couple of fists, named Cosmo, started by a company called Anki. Anki, you can love for other reasons. They have robotic slot cars. They just came out with a Fast and Furious version of robotic slot cars. The thing about slot cars that are robots is they can actually determine that they can perceive other cars around them, and they have other behaviors that your robotic slot cars didn't have when you were, you know. This guy is a little helper, and he can walk around and really just picks up boxes and reflects some amount of a personality. But it's why it's very interesting is not just because it has an SDK now, so you can have it follow lines and do other things, but because it is an expression of the leading edge of robot-human interaction. Fun fact for anybody that goes by this, I'll give you a little secret. If you kind of throw him on his back, he'll waddle around like a turtle trying to get up, and he won't be able to. So he'll get bored and start playing Pong on his face. The eyes are meant to convey emotion. So as it comes up to you, it does learn you, and it learns your face, and it will in some really crazy way try to pronounce your name, Eric, right? It sounds kind of creepy in some ways, but it does recognize me when it comes up, better than my, as well as my dog. It doesn't ask for food, but it does convey a personality. The things we learn from that, things you'd learn if you bought one, and I'm not a shareholder, but when this robot wants to come towards you, it recognizes your face, it doesn't turn away and then walk and then turns towards you, although that would be the computationally the most efficient thing to do, because what they found is people get freaked out if the robot turns away. It's unpredictable behavior. So what it instead does is kind of waddles towards you. So it looks like it's coming up on you. It knows you're aware. It knows you exist. These are the types of things that very early stages you think, well, that's just dumb. But it helps in people getting familiar with technology with which they otherwise would not be familiar. Now, some people have gotten this memo. Other interesting research about this, actually. So size matters. As the size grows in a robot, we expect it to have perfection. If a big dishwasher works 100 times but it fails two, we're going to remember the two. That might seem kind of intuitive, but the funny thing is, as the robot shrinks, Cosmos really remember really small, it makes mistakes, and it will make mistakes, we're more forgiving of it for whatever reason. But that's demonstrated evidence in the adoption of this. Second thing is that personality matters. And you're going to actually see this. Some people say, well, what I want is I want dumb items in my house. I want them to be smart insofar as they have sensors. But what you're going to start seeing, if I can make a prediction, because I know this is coming, is 2, 3, 4 years, you're going to start seeing some of the devices in your house have personality, and it'll start to recognize you. As Cosmo misses a block, what it does is it expresses disappointment. Imagine if your dishwasher did that. Sorry, I got the plate dirty. Sorry, it took so long. You know, it sighs. It really sighs. It makes noise. It moves around. If it misses a box and it has a little game it plays with you, it actually gets angry and shakes. Personality is going to be a useful tool for you in developing technologies. This is not something that we have to worry about in terms of a black box. It's something actually to accommodate the black box that kind of inevitably is going to be there in the adoption of some technology. So some people have experimented with this, right? Asimo from Honda is actually pretty short, right? Pretty darn short, so then we're a little more forgiving. You can imagine the reaction would be a little different if Asimo was 7 feet tall, right? Wouldn't be as friendly. And this is important as we're engaging with society that we don't freak people out, because this would kind of freak people out, right? That would freak people out. And it matters as we start to build trust, because even in things that are supposed to give us safety, if we don't, we're not really sensitive to that, you know, the whole industry can be affected. Now, some very sophisticated people at very sophisticated companies are doing this. So don't think that this is something crazy. They've kind of gotten the memo that it needs to look friendly. It didn't have to look like this. Right? This is an expression of trying to be familiar, trying to be accepting, trying to be, you know, warm or inviting. It didn't have to look like this, right? It could have looked like this. They chose a particular design. This one's cooler, but not what they chose. So that is the ways we can think about trust. Right, FICO score is the gold standard for actually measuring trust. We might do something similar in machine intelligence. So I was actually at a AAAS meeting where I'm happy to be participating in the early committee for the launch of the new science journal, Robotics. Anybody already subscribing to this thing? Probably not. But it just came out. Science Robotics, check it out, it's very cool. But we may develop a third-party mechanism to be evaluating these best practices in machine intelligence and deploying products in this domain. And remember, these are context-dependent, completely context-dependent when we're talking about trust. Trust is a very rich conversation, but it's trust in a particular domain. You might trust me with policy conversations, but you may not trust me to fix a 12-course meal. And also, even if you don't think trust impacts you now, it may in the future. We've had companies that have started and their businesses isn't in trust. but they've evolved over time. Right? Trust is a huge part of their business now. So, and what you trust them for evolves over time. Did trust them just to have a comprehensive catalog and deliver the book when they said it, the price they said it, but you trust them for a whole new range of experiences today. And that mechanism that they invented has become sufficiently adopted that other people base whole businesses on it, right? Just on a trust mechanism. We may be able to do that, right? You can explore that. And should you, there's other ways of expressing trust, of course. Balance sheet's an interesting one. But once you've developed this level of trust, it's actually going to be a competitive advantage for you as an entrepreneur, you as an academic even. Definitely you as an investor, you as a board member. It could be a huge competitive advantage because you can actually then explore other areas of the world with your newfound trust. You can brand it, and now people will trust a set of experiences that you have, that you've been able to create. And please don't screw it up for the rest of us. This is a University of Illinois study where we're working with elderly people on how they experience robots in a world that's not quite available yet. So this is Dr. Sonia Kim working with the patient client. And this is what they're seeing. See, that's a drone in the living room. And the drone's gonna come at you in different ways. So you can vary the speed, the proximity to you, the variability to you, and we can measure your skin resistance to kind of synthetically reproduce the degree to which you may be nervous. So we can see how robots should behave around different people that makes them accepting or non-accepting. Because right now, it's a pretty crude mechanism. Yellow robots kill you, put them behind the walls. That's it. Quite literally, from Fennec, but these are Fennec robots, their latest technology for the collaborative robots, the ones that can come at you and you can kind of press back gently, is paint them green. Green ones are safe, yellow ones will kill you. It's a safety issue. All right? So these are context dependent. What we actually trust this robot to do is really, really tight. What we trust these robots might say, this sort of intelligence to do, is be comprehensive. How do we communicate this sort of trust? Kind of an open question right now. In privacy, we just have the HTTPS and green air bar on our URL window. We haven't yet invented a way of communicating that trust. So when you're actually driving, it still can be a little sketchy, right? I don't know if anybody drives their Tesla quite this way. It gets a little tiring, but it can be testy. This is really important as we have a broader spectrum of policy considerations. You know, really unlike other technologies with which we've been familiar, this has a policy component. This is why we went in to government, is because this is really necessary. It's kind of responsible. And the possible problem is we could have a backlash. That's what this whole talk is about. It's about please help us not have a backlash. This is Dodd-Frank. Nobody's ever read it. It's like 20,000 pages, literally. And it's really our latest poster child for legislative overreach. Even the champions of it say, hey, we need to revise it. Nobody wants to touch it because once you start getting into a little, then it creates this whole large debate. But even the champions of it thought it was a little too much. Right? Please let's not do this for technology. And be aware that we do have some, you know, generational issues. We need to be conscious of that. And as our population ages, we need to make sure we don't just have this cloying way of working with robots. I mean, hopefully we can do better at that. One way you can do better is just be impeccable. Impeccability, this kind of a general rule, impeccability breeds trust. So impeccability in our behavior, I would say, as an industry, as academics. And this is especially just important as our technology evolves, just to kind of stay in the lines and create clear expectations of what we are going to be delivering to society, because the benefits are manifold. And as a larger percentage of our population with which the familiarity with robots doesn't and really will never match ours, we need to be responsible for the trust that's given to us in bringing together these abstract patterns into a coherent way that that other people might be able to understand it as weather. And they need to trust these robots, to trust machines with their jobs and ultimately with their lives, so that when somebody knows that you're doing machine intelligence, they'll say, you're the type of person that helps people. Thank you very much.